Welcome, welcome, welcome to those who are still hanging in there with these videos, because it's getting a lot better, actually. The message in this video is amazing. I'll set the table for it. Was lying in bed this morning in dawn and sort of in and out of dreaming consciousness, as it were, and I was driving this dream where I had this problem with something on my leg, some sort of growth on my leg or something like that. And I was saying, oh my God, I got this problem. How do I fix it? How do I fix it? How do I fix it? And then my attention somehow was diverted a little bit. And I looked back at the leg and there was no problem. And it's like the problem had just evaporated and disappeared. And then I caught it. I said, hey, wait a minute. There wasn't any problem with my leg. I was imagining it. It was an imaginary problem. So you don't need to fix an imaginary problem. You only need to see that it's imaginary. And then it disappears. And you see there was nothing wrong with my leg at all. And yet I was having this dream of obsessing with how do I fix this problem? How do I fix this problem? Okay, so this is setting the scene for what happened. Then I started contemplating this and say, hey, wait a minute. I wonder if all problems aren't imaginary. And it went like that. All my problems are imaginary. And then I say, hey, wait a minute. If all my problems are imaginary, isn't it likely that everyone's problems are imaginary? So all problems are imaginary for everyone, everywhere. And I said, hey, wait a minute. Can reality have a problem? Can there be some problem with reality? A problem with perfection? No. Can everywhereness not be everywhere right now? No. So there can't be any real problems. So if they're not real problems, what are they? They're imaginary problems. So I said, hey, okay. So obviously the answer is not to fix imaginary problems. It's to see them as imaginary. And then they vanish. Poof, like a dream, like waking up from a dream. Now, the new graphic artwork on the top of the channel, Escape the Fourth Dimensional Matrix. Escape the Fourth Dimensional Matrix. This is a pragmatic position. Ultimately, we're escaping delusion. But from a pragmatic standpoint, we have this fourth dimensional matrix being instilled in like a prison planet. The fourth dimensional matrix, what is that? The fourth dimensional matrix is a situation of extreme pride in solving problems. Okay, this is maybe a very good way to describe it. And the position, if you were to take a position in the fourth dimensional matrix and say there are no problems, they would label you as insane, categorically, instantly, because their whole pride and the belief in their identity is the ability to, an advanced ability to solve problems. That's what it's all about. Now, third dimensionals, pure third dimensionals, are not so interested in solving problems. Some, but not that intense pride. And as we have developed towards a fourth dimensional matrix, we've gotten more and more involved in problems, solving problems. So along comes somebody who says, there are no problems. Of course, you say that's complete insanity. It invalidates everything that they think that they're all about. So a fourth dimensional matrix is not a good place it's not a good dance to dance at all. So we're here to help you escape this fourth dimensional matrix, because truly, there are no problems. They're only imaginary problems. You do not resolve the situation of imaginary problems by making the problem real and then, quote unquote, fixing it. You know, like in this instance, I had something on my leg or something, cancer, whatever. Oh, okay, it's real, but we'll do surgery, we'll fix it like that. No, it's solved by realizing it was imaginary, it was never there. So this is what's called the fifth dimensional approach, quote unquote. We're just using these terms to differentiate it from the fourth dimensional matrix. A matrix is a control, hive mind control mechanism, a overall gestalt mindset, as it were, of saying this is our identity, this is what's important, this is what's happening. We're fixing problems. We're focused on fixing problems. Whereas in truth, there are no problems. So it's kind of like a hell. It's upside down backwards to truth. And it's difficult to get teaching into this fourth dimensional matrix because of their knee-jerk reaction of labeling anyone who says there are no problems as completely insane. Now, in the third dimension, you can say this and people will laugh at you and say, well, good luck with that, and scratch their heads a bit and say, well, you know, I don't know how you do that. But they won't automatically pursue, they say. They won't say, well, we need to put you in this intense lockdown mental hospital and do genetic splicing on you and drugs, this, that, or, you know, therapy. We need to cure you. You got a severe problem. They're not so into that. It's just live and let live. You want to say there's no problems? Okay, good luck to you. They may laugh and say, you know, a little bit cuckoo or something. But there is not this draconian response, not so much. Fourth dimensional matrix, there's a draconian response. It says, you're saying there's no problems? You have an insanely severe problem then, and we're going to have to fix you. We're going to have to give you a ton of problems, help you realize that problems are where it's at. Because how can we solve problems if there aren't problems? So this is very important to realize. Why are we trying to solve problems? Because we're competing with God. We want to be greater than God. In reality, there are no problems. Are no problems. So there's no problem solving. So what we're saying to God is, hey, God, we see a lot of problems with reality. There's nothing but problems. But we're solving them, you see. We're greater than you are. We have problems. So it's competition with God is what the fourth dimensional matrix is really about. And it's very severe. It's a very severe situation. So, of course, we want to escape that. Now, I was reading in A Course in Miracles what Jesus said. The very heart essence of what he's saying is that no, it's impossible to be healed alone. When you're healed, everyone is healed with you. When you are healed, everyone is healed with you. And I say, what is he talking about? You know, it's like, but I just said, okay, I accept this. Somehow it's going to be clarified. Well, obviously, if you realize that all your problems are imaginary, then it's easy to realize everyone's problems are imaginary. So if you accept that you don't have any problems, you easily say nobody has any problems. So your healing is everyone's healing because you extend this realization to everyone. No one has any problems. So you're not healed alone, you see? It's not like you say, well, all my problems are imaginary and everyone else's problems are real. No, because you realize there aren't any real problems. Reality doesn't have any problem. So therefore, no one at all has any problem whatsoever, any real problem whatsoever. Absolutely not. So everyone is healed together. So this is what Jesus is getting at. And I have this epiphany now of understanding, of getting that. So I say, I don't have any financial problem. Nobody has a financial problem. I extend it to everyone. There are no financial problems for anyone. There are no health problems for anyone. I don't even have to talk about myself. It's just for everyone. I'm included in that. There are no problems. No one has any problems whatsoever. That's how I'm seeing it. And this is true. That we're only hallucinating our problems. Problem. Total imagination. Like a dream. It's not even there. But this is, of course, the intellect cannot get this. Because it's a problem solver. that's what it does. We say this is, you know, we want to solve problems, so the intellect is working on solving problems. So we cannot understand there are no problems, but there's something within us that can get that and accept it. All is everywhere nowness. I can say I am everywhere nowness. All is everywhere nowness. All is equally present in this moment, is it not? Is there a problem with that? There's certainly no problem with that, right? That all appearance and non-appearance is equally present to this very moment. See, this is a non-perceptual statement. It's a true statement, though. A star a million light years away and the sun, right this moment, this very moment, are equally present in that moment. Distance and location, relative location, doesn't have anything to do with it whatsoever. Presence, location has nothing to do with presence in the moment. So each moment is flawless. Each moment is actually totally flawless. We can at least realize that. It's that nothing is excluded from the moment, both manifest and unmanifest. All unmanifestness is equally present to that moment too. It's equally unmanifest in that very moment. But to say, well, I have no problems, that gets it more pragmatic, doesn't it? Now, the intellect will not understand this. Okay, we understand that. We're not trying to explain this to the intellect. And we say, well, what do we do with our intellect then? What do we do with our problem solving? That's why we need to practice the mood of repentance, sitting quietly. So that when we realize these great realizations, epiphanies, breakthroughs, we don't kick the intellect into gear and the intellect to say, okay, great, now how do I solve these problems? Or how does this help me be a better problem solver? The realization that we have no problems obviously doesn't make us a better problem solver. So we have to, the shock of, hey, we don't really need to solve any problems. We don't need a problem solver. We don't need to identify ourselves as problem solvers. See, we have identified ourselves with problem solving, whether on an intellectual way or an emotional way or however. There's all sorts of ways we try to solve problems. We identify ourselves as problem solvers. And so we're dropping that identity. There are no problems to solve. There can be the seeming illusion of problem solve, but turn the illusion over to the Holy Spirit and let the Holy Spirit deal with this illusion of time and space and form. Not us. Now that's the Holy Spirit's job, actually. So I say, nobody has any money problems at all. There are no money problems. There are no survival problems. There are no health problems. Let the Holy Spirit deal with that, okay? It's a reality, it's true. But there's all these mirages, you know, that people are believing in, these mirages. But it's true right now. Now, as long as we believe in time and space and form, it will seem like it needs to play out somehow. But we can, for ourselves, we can accept it for everything right now. We can accept it for everything right now. But that right now acceptance seems to play out in time and space. That's the Holy Spirit's play. We can just accept it for ourselves and then not worry anymore. And others who want to continue to try and fix problems, of course, they will seemingly be dealing with all the issues, etc. Because that's what they want. But we don't have to see it as a problem for them. We can realize that they don't really have that problem. No one has any problems. There are no problems. So here's where the rubber meets the road, where the, where we part ways with the problem-solving intellect, as it were, and assert the truth over that intellect, because the intellect will, you know, want to push back on it. But we're at a point now where no, we just stay in the mood of repentance like this, and don't even entertain quibbles by the intellect, because the intellect can never get it. So why even engage with it? It cannot understand. It cannot get this at all. Imagine if there's a world that was totally enshrouded in deep, deep dark fog, and then someone in the world, wherever they were, it was sunlight, beautiful sunlight. And as they moved through the world, the sunlight moved with them, the beautiful sunlight moved with them. But as they moved, behind them, where they had left, the fog seems to close in again. Like that, but it never closes in on their sunlight, you see. This is kind of like how we can function in the world, knowing that there are no problems. See, in the perfect, beautiful, shining sunlight, there's no fog at all, no fog. So we show people, there's no fog, it's all hallucination. And yet those who want to, you know, keep hallucinating, say, no, I want the hallucinations, I want to, so, you don't dispel other hallucinations. You just show them it is a hallucination. So it is possible to function in this world problem-free. You don't have any problems whatsoever. And yet others seem to maintain their problems. But you know they don't have any problems, actually. They're just imagining these things. Up above the fog, the sun is shining, right? The sun is not having problems shining just because we put ourselves and shroud ourselves in fog. The sun's not having any problems shining at all. We're just imagining the fog is light. See, the light has this problem of fog. No, no, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. So, to some extent, we have to accept this spiritually and say, "I know this is true. I know it is true." Now, how illusions disappear doesn't really matter, does it? Doesn't matter. Because there is no knowledge of fixing problems. So it's not like we're missing out on some sort of knowledge. Like, well, how does it disappear exactly? I want to know the process of a disappearance. That's totally unnecessary. It only seems to take time to vanish for the sake of continuity. All right, so it only seems to play out in time and space, but really, it's poof, never was there. So how we make something that was never there, you know, not there, it is totally beside the point. It's not necessary to know how to solve problems, because there are no problems. So how your life gets cleared up, it is not your concern, actually. It's not our concern. How everyone's life gets... Holy Spirit knows every detail of everything. So, always, every moment. So, how it plays that out is its play. That's its play. All we do is we abide in this problem-free realization. All everywhere nowness. All is everywhere nowness. All is everywhere nowness. All is nowness. And we need to get this. We need to accept this as soon as possible. So pressure's on us for sure. Big pressure. Because the fourth dimensional matrix is congealing and crystallizing as we speak. As we speak. Where the pressure is upon everyone to focus on problem solving. And thus, of course, the realization there are no problems will seem to be very taboo, very taboo. And it will seem to be choosing insanity. That's the problem with the fourth dimensional matrix. It will seem as if you're choosing to be completely insane. And nobody would choose to be completely insane. You see that? That's the trouble with it. So I do not know how my circumstances will play out. I really don't know. But the whatever problems we think we have are simply our attempt, and maybe the collective attempt, part of the collective attempt of spirit to change reality so that we can say we're greater than reality. It's trying to compete with God, trying to create a separate reality. And it represents what we believe to be problems, and then we feel we have a challenge to fix those problems. Now, in that dream I had of a problem with my leg, it just vanished, and I realized it was never there. So did I try to make it come back so I could fix it? No, I was glad. Oh, that was just an imagination. I was just imagining that. And so just let it go. Just let it go. Don't try to bring it back. And I really do have this attitude of really not being interested in solving any problems. I don't want to try to fix the world's problems. So now in the fourth dimension, those who realize there are no problems, they are not recognized. You know, it's not like the fourth dimension has all the spiritual truth in it at all. No, it doesn't. It's a spiritual desert. Because it's all about solving problems. And of course, spiritual truth is all about realizing there are no problems. There have never been any problems whatsoever. It's all a mirage. Imagine if we were driving on a road through the desert, and you were a driver and you had a passenger. See, a passenger is like a fourth dimensional. You're like a fifth dimensional. And the fourth dimensional starts getting real nervous, and you say, "What's up? Why are you so nervous?" The fourth dimensional says, "Well, I just noticed that I just noticed that we're driving towards this huge mountain, you know, and I don't know, I don't see any road around the mountain, and we're now in this desert, and I just wonder if you don't seem to, you know, recognize your attitude is kind of like, just like we're freewheeling through this open desert, and there's this huge mountain right across the road, you know, the road ends right here." And you say, "What are you talking about?" Well, the fifth dimensional says, knowing that the fourth dimensional is hallucinating, that there's this huge mountain across the road, okay. So you keep driving, and the fourth dimensional is getting more and more nervous. It's, "Whoa, slow down," you know. And as you get real close to this mountain, they're hallucinating. There's this solid mountain right there. They get freaking out. "Let me out, stop the car, you know, let me out. You're gonna kill us all. And it's just like, and you keep driving. And of course, you just keep driving the road. And the fourth dimensional says, oh my God, we entered the mountain. We're inside the mountain now. It's all pitch dark. I can't see, you know. Ah, oh, it's crazy. Ah, they're freaking out. And then you keep driving, and then eventually the hallucination maybe is they feel they've gone through the mountain. And they say, oh, come out the other side. I said, oh my God, we're out the other side now. Of course, you driving, there's never been any mountain at all. It's just completely free, open, beautiful spaciousness. And so they think that somehow you drove through a solid mountain. And they say, wow, this is a miracle. It's magic. It's unbelievable. How did you do that? How did you fix that problem? I said, this is a problem, a whole mountain, and you just drove right through the mountain. How did you do that? It's amazing. It's a miracle. Dude, that's no miracle. There never was a mountain there. And I say, no, I saw the mountain. It was obviously there. So, see, that's the problem. So they'll say you're some great magician or something. You somehow you warped time and space, and you had some sort of special energy field, and you know they start trying to figure out how did you solve that problem. See, and that's the fourth dimensionals. They're into solving the problems of how to manipulate time and space and all appearances and everything. And I said, I didn't solve any problem. It was never there in the first place. And they say, ah, you know, well, that's not helpful. You're not helping me. You must be crazy. You just don't even know what happened. So how do you get genuine spiritual teaching in the fourth dimension is the question. Because none of what they're seeing is there, actually. It's all hallucination. It's all a mirage. What they were seeing was a mirage of their own imagination, which is an expression of their desire to see a problem with reality. And then their happiness comes then from solving the problem, you see. When we want to be greater than God, we have to see reality as a problem. There's some problem with it. Or that we can make it fail. Make fail to be perfect. It's a failure to be perfect. Here's a problem. And then we say, well, my happiness then, in my new creation, where I'm prime creator and I realize there's a problem with reality, is to solve the problem, and then I'll be happy. So the fourth dimensionals believe that they have the answer to happiness. They're the ones making the big push to happiness, because they're the ones who are adept at problem solving. But in reality, there is no problem to solve. There are no problems to solve at all. And happiness comes from this realization. So as we go closer and closer to the fourth dimensional matrix, in fact, where it's crystallizing right now as we speak, anyone who asserts this position, there are no problems, is called more and more, the verbiage. And the definition and delineation is more and more that they're insane, more and more that way. If you look at just like 50 years ago, and like a teacher like Nisargadatta in Bombay, India, you know, the interlocutors, the questioners would come. They go back and forth. And maybe the questioners would say, you're crazy, you're insane. You know, they'd say like that. And Nisargadatta would say, well, come on over and see it, how I'm seeing it, and then tell me if I'm insane. And they say, huh, okay. That's as far as it went. They understood that maybe he's right. You know, maybe he's right. Okay, so around all these teachers in the world 50 years ago, we said, hey, you know, they're probably right, and we're probably wrong. That's the feeling. It was respect for the teachers that we had, great respect. And even though our intellect could not understand what they're talking about, still we would say, the fault is mine, you know. The fault is mine. I'm the one who's deluded, not the teacher. Now, as we're getting closer, as this fourth dimensional matrix is crystallizing, inescapably now you hear from all angles that these teachers were charlatans, they're crazy, they're insane, they don't know what they're talking about, this is nonsense. You know, rubbish. That's what you're getting more and more. That these teachers were actually totally insane and irrelevant. That's the crystallization of the fourth dimensional matrix. Now, you still have a little bit of pockets of stuff happening here and there, but the overall mood and attitude among society, the expression, the extreme, intense expression that you get so much now, is way different than it used to be. I remember the people would say, "Ah, maybe he's on drugs," or the teacher said, "Ah, maybe he's on drugs, I don't know." And that's about as far as it went. Kind of shrugged your shoulders and says, maybe they're on drugs, I don't know what their problem is. But now, the others are the ferocious, focused attitude of suppression, repression. We need to get rid of this. We need to stamp this out. We need to stamp it out now, like it's a social problem, a severe social problem. Wasn't the way. That was not the way in the past. There was an undercurrent of that, a little bit, but now it's boiling. It's boiling. Boiling over, as a matter of fact. So I say, escape the fourth dimensional matrix. Absolutely. Because you'll just be tilting at windmills there. Tilting at windmills, we'd all be Don Quixotes. Fourth dimension is all Don Quixotes. Tilting at windmills, taking on these imaginary monsters. All these movies and stuff are helping people imagine all these monsters and terrible stuff, you know, so they can try to fix that problem. When we say that catastrophes are coming, problems are coming, well, yes, in our collective imagination, hallucination, mirage, the mirage will dance and play in all sorts of ways for those who want to fix problems. A mirage of problems will arise for them. Hallucination will arise, and they will think, "Oh my God, I'm overwhelmed. These are incredible, intense problems. We all need to get together collectively and work on these problems. We need to have a hive mind. We need to share ideas. We need to be connected. We all got to work on these problems together. You know, that's the fourth dimension. Together, we will solve all problems." No, together you hallucinate even bigger problems, is what happens. Hallucinate even bigger problems. But eventually you get to really say, "Oh my God, the whole universe is a problem." Well, we got to imagine a new universe then. You know, together we can imagine a new universe. Because it gets like that. It's never ending. So, the fact that some seem to be escaping the problems of a mirage, they may know it is a mirage, but in time and space it plays out, it seems as though they're escaping the problems of a mirage. It may seem that way. I don't know exactly how the Holy Spirit plays it all out. Well, but we don't have to. That's not a problem. The intellect says, "Okay, well, how is the Holy Spirit going to fix all this time and space and appearance?" No, that's it. The Holy Spirit does it holistically, not perceptually. So intellect is dealing from standpoint of perception. Holy Spirit is dealing from it from the standpoint of all is everywhereness right now, manifest and unmanifest. So it never leaves the moment. The Holy Spirit never leaves the moment, which is something our perception is never in the moment. So we cannot understand perceptually, intellectually, emotionally. We cannot understand how the Holy Spirit is able to deal with all this. As far as, you know, to the extent that we have let go of our desire to fix problems, to that extent, then it seems as though problems drop away from us, right? But really, our experience is problems drop away from everyone. Problems drop away from everyone. So we go towards a condition of seeing that nobody has any problems. So we see everyone as everything as it really is. We go beyond seeing anyone as bodies, as forms. Because forms are just a hallucination, actually. We've never actually been born. Spirit's never been born. We've hallucinated forms that aren't really there. They're not really true. something from Punja G, the teacher in Lucknow. Watched a video, very, very profound video, maybe the best I've seen of him. And he says, you know, when you realize, you know, why was I born? You realize this. He said, that's the end of your birth and death, but it's the end of your birth. Very interesting. Because you realize you were never born. And realizing you're never born is the end of your birth. I've never heard it put that way before. That's actually very good. Why should we be trying to get rid of our death? We should be trying to get rid of our birth. That's what's important. And we get rid of it by realizing we've never been born. We're not trying to fix our birth, you know, fix things. We never were born in the first place. And he knew that, you know, he could see it. He realized that. So, you know, then people would say, yeah, wow, that's great. That's very heavy. I like that. And in the fourth dimensional matrix, they say, what are you talking about? You definitely were born. You're born. Your purpose is why was I born is the question. Oh, you're born to solve problems, of course. There's no, you know, instantly, I was born to solve problems. That's my purpose here. Our happiness, where's happiness come from? It comes from solving problems, of course. So they have this ideology, a cult-like ideology, all in place. That's the Matrix. Matrix is a cult-like ideology of the fourth dimension. Of they know we were born to solve problems, and our happiness comes from solving problems. End of discussion. There is no discussion. They're very sure of this. Very sure of this. And anyone who's not sure of it is inferior to them. And one who denies the entire premise that they have, it must be completely insane and needs to be re-educated. That's their goal. So they seem very confident. The fourth dimensional seem very confident. Because they're operating from a cult-like matrix system where the answers are already given to them. They say, yeah, I know exactly why I was born, exactly why I'm here, exactly what my purpose is, and exactly how to be happy. There's no question about it at all. I just need to perform. I just need to perform. So they go through life, you know, performing, solving problems. And they say, this will bring me happiness. It's not even, you know, they're not even questioning it. So of course in that situation, like robots, really, you know, robots can seem very confident, right? Just all their movements, just, you know, they seem like very confident. So the fourth dimensional seem very confident because they think they have all the answers. There's no questioning going on within them. I said, hey, wait a minute, you know. Those who are questioning, of course, seem to lack confidence. But what they really, situation is, they lack confidence in insanity. They lack confidence in mirages. They say, hey, I think this is a mirage. I'm not sure, I think it's a mirage. So of course, they seem not so confident. So, like for my situation, I seem to lack confidence. I had a ton of confidence when I was young, but then, you know, that eroded. I'm not sure if the confidence when I was young came from feeling that I knew that I was here to solve problems, or I knew that there are no problems. But in any case, once we start questioning, then we seem to lose confidence. And of course, those who were very certain of their purpose here seem to, you know, can function, just, you know, seem to function great. And if you're really doubtful about everything, then you're hesitant, you're not sure how to function, and you seem to be very dysfunctional. And the fourth dimensionals think that that's a mental problem. They say, oh, you're dysfunctional, it's a mental problem. You see, you need to be more confident. You need to know, and say, well, here we know the answers, here are the answers. This is, you're born to solve problems, that means solving problems is your happiness. And they tell you this, you see, which is really insanity. So for them, insanity they think is happiness. But eventually, you know, the problems seem to be bigger and bigger and bigger as they get more and more sense of, you know, I need to have happiness now, I gotta solve the big problem. Bigger and bigger, bigger problems arise. Now Krishnamurti, the great Krishnamurti, pointed out to us back in the 50s, back in the 1950s, he said that there will be a new generation, a new type of person, mindset, coming into this world fairly soon, he said. And they will be extremely materialistically minded. And they will be so certain of themselves that they will end up dominating this planet. So that was the fourth dimensional matrix. Krishnamurti knew the fourth dimensional matrix was going to crystallize on this planet. Back in the 1950s, he knew this. It was absolutely correct. And these people seem so certain of themselves and seem so functional, incredibly functional, don't they? Because they think they know their purpose here and they know how to be happy, and then they're pursuing their happiness. And then it's like, you know, no problems as far as that, why we're here to fix problems. So that's not a problem for us. So of course they seem to be dominating here. And then those of us who are saying, whoa, wait a minute. I don't think this is right. What about what Nisargadatta said? What about this Jesus said? Buddha said, what about these teachers? And of course these fourth dimensionals, they say, totally irrelevant. It's just, those people were cuckoo, just a myth. Either they didn't even exist, or they didn't know what they were talking about, or it's just nonsense. And they don't give it a second thought. It's just dismissed like water off a duck's back. And the rest of us are not quite that way, are saying, well, wait a minute, you know, this sort of resonates with me. And they say, no, you're just lazy. You know, you're not fit for problem solving. I say, well, wait a minute. Maybe all our problems are imaginary, actually. They say, no, they're just lazy. You're not fit for the fourth dimension. You need to be re-educated and retooled and refurbished, you know, so you could get it right, you know, and agree with them. So, of course, they seem to be taking over the planet. It's easy for them to take over this planet because the rest of us are actually wrestling with truth and trying to repent, you see. That's a struggle. So, of course, we're not super functional like they are. Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit. Those are the ones that shall be saved. That's what he was talking about. As you wrestle with these doubts and say, wait a minute, whoa, I'm not so sure, and ask these questions, you will seem to be less functional, meaning poor in spirit. Whereas the ones who are so sure that fixing problems is their purpose and that's their that's where happiness will be found, they don't seem to have any second thoughts about what they're doing. It's boom, 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 like robots. They seem to be rich in spirit as far as spiritedness, as far as getting stuff done, as functioning, you see. But Jesus said, no, it's the poor in spirit. Those are the ones who shall inherit the kingdom of perfection. Because they're the ones who are wrestling and struggling with all this stuff. And they may not be functioning very well, as a matter of fact. I've never been functioning well. Cannot compete. Because I'm saying, well, I wake up in the morning, I say, I need to take, you know, 4 hours here. I need to really consider what I just saw. This is just mind-blowing stuff. That this problem never existed. I just made it up. I was imagining it. And then you need to generalize this. You need to, you know, let it generalize. So I can't be running out, you know, boom, 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 like a robot chasing after billions, you know. It's not possible. So that means I seem to be poor in spirit, meaning dispirited as far as brisk functionality and progress and problem solvingness. Don't have that. Don't have it at all. Very sluggish, slow, kind of look like I'm burdened, you know. Well, that's because I'm looking at my belief system and saying, wow, you know, I need to make this exchange of perception and vision. I need to exchange perception for vision. And I realize that no one has any problems, and so how am I going to function here? There's all this consideration going on all the time. So I seem to be burdened, weighed down and burdened. Whereas the fourth dimensionals, you know, they're making deals, new deal, yeah, get this, get that. They just seem so like robotically functional. Jesus said, the first will be last, and the last will be first. And this is another way of putting it. Is the ones that seem to be just, you know, like, wow, it's so heavy, this realization. Wow, I'm so stunned and shocked by it. You know, I can hardly function. It's amazing that there are no problems. You know, no one has any problems. Holy cow. You know, they seem to be last, you know, as far as functionality goes, right? And the ones who are first are the robotic people who think they know exactly, oh yeah, I'm a problem solver, I fix problems, that's how it makes me happy, like a robot. Those will be the last to enter the kingdom of heaven. Those are the ones who have to turn that around. But those who are seem to be the last in this world, struggling so much with these really incredible realizations. And it is a struggle. When you get all these realizations, it just floors you. You know, it just floors you. It's just, wow. It's the great good news floors you. So this is such great good news, I can hardly stand it. Those are seem to be the last. Those are the ones that enter the kingdom of heaven first. Kingdom of heaven is, of course, realization. There are no problems for anyone. There are no problems. All is everywhere nowness. All is everywhereness right now. All is everywhereness right now. Everywhere nowness. All is everywhere nowness. All is everywhere nowness. That includes me, includes you, includes every. All is everywhere nowness. First will be last, and the last will be first. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the kingdom, really. The true kingdom, the kingdom of perfection, which is the only kingdom there really is. Everything else is just a hallucination. So we certainly don't want to try and compete with these robotic type of mindsets. Fourth dimensional mindsets. Certainly don't want to compete with them. We certainly don't want to feel like we need to compete with them either. That's the trouble, is they're adjusting everything in the world, the whole economics of the world. The education, the economics, the healthcare, everything is being adjusted to suit their belief system, which is go, 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 go. Brisk. Past problem fixing mindsets, type A personality, so to speak. It's just whirlwinds of activity of fixing things. They just take on, you know, let's take on this, look at this problem, let's take that on, we can fix that. There's that attitude like, wow, I can fix this, I can fix the ecosystem, I can fix the atmosphere, I can fix the climate, let's fix the carbon emissions, let's fix. It's like that. And so if you're not part of that, you end up being, you know, basically unable to function here. For instance, if you don't use a smartphone now, more and more, you're having problems functioning, actually, in a lot of ways. Especially if you don't use a computer, good luck. But if you don't use a smartphone, there's so many different things now I'm noticing that they're trying to get, everyone to use smartphones. Why? They think it's quicker, it's faster. It helps solve problems quicker and faster. And that's what they're all about. So let's solve problems quicker and faster. But if you're not interested in solving any problems at all, because there are no, you're interested in realizing there are no problems. What do you need a smartphone for? Why do you need to fix problems fast, so to speak? Why do you need that? Don't. So there's a marginalization taking place in the world. I'm aware of that, acutely aware that there's this massive marginalization to the point of just pushing out those who can't get with the pace. There's like a pace, the fourth dimensions have this pace about them. I've heard people testify to me, like in college students and high school students, various people from all walks of life have just sort of dropped some testimony on me. And they say, it's just a killer pace. This one man said in college, he said, I have to just drink energy drinks all the time just to keep up with the pace. He says, you can't believe the pace. And if you're late to a class, you'll be kicked out. Someone else, there's 100 students waiting to get in the class. And you can't keep up with the pace, that you're out. And he says, I don't sleep very much. I can't afford to sleep. I got to try to keep up. He's just like, God, he's like, you see these people, these young people who are trying to keep up with this pace. And they may be some deep thinkers saying, oh, wait a minute, I'm not sure. See, And when you're that not sure, you can't keep up the pace. It's this robotic certainty that the fourth dimensionals have, the cyborg robotic certainty that is setting this pace. And if you can't keep up, he said, hey, if I don't keep up, I'll be kicked out. I'll lose this class. I'll lose the credits. I can't graduate. He said, it's a nightmare. He said, it's an absolute nightmare. It's driving me, you know, it's ruining my health. I've been doing this for years. I saw him. I just said, wow. I guess he knew that I sort of saw something. I just like, so he was confessing to me, you know, like this is the problem I have. Now, this is all very well and good to explain this, but of course everyone's saying, well, yeah, this situation here, you know, is killer. It's a killer situation, isn't it? Yeah, it is. Absolutely it is. So what do we do about it is the question. That's a big question. There's only the Holy Spirit can answer that question, actually. So you should ask the Holy Spirit. Definitely, you cannot afford to be without the Holy Spirit during these times. You cannot think that some teacher, someone anywhere sharing something is going to have the answer that is powerful enough for you. So what I'm saying is that you have to ask the Holy Spirit. And you have to get comfortable with asking the Holy Spirit to clarify for you, and then you'll see it extend out to everyone. Don't expect some person, you know, in the world to have the answers exactly for everyone with what are they supposed to do. That's the Holy Spirit's job. But what I'm doing here is trying to help people get comfortable with the Holy Spirit and saying, well, this is what, you know, how it helps. You ask for help, you pray for help, and somehow it helps in ways that you may have not foreseen. Like you come across something that just triggers, like, oh, just like that little dream I had triggered this whole entire, you know, awareness of there's no problems. A quote that I read that I was pointed out, just randomly opened the Course in Miracles book, and there's this quote on healing. It says, you're not healed alone. You're never healed alone. I said, wow, what's that mean? And then suddenly it came to me today, later, like, oh, that's what is meant. You're never healed alone. Meaning, the fact you realize there are no problems is healing for everyone, you included. So, the fourth dimensional matrix, to escape it, you need the Holy Spirit. Plain and simple. The Holy Spirit is with everyone. So you need to ask the Holy Spirit for some help. Say, hey, Holy Spirit, please help me. Please help me escape this insanity about problems and problem solving. However you want to put it. Now, as you listen to the Holy Spirit, you won't need external help as much, external teachers as much, you know, those who reassure you. You won't need them as much. A little bit now and then, for sure. A Course in Miracles said the purpose of the book is make itself obsolete, that you don't need it anymore. Because you had transferred your inner dialogue over the Holy Spirit and saying, turn to the Holy Spirit and say, okay, you know, work miracles in my life, compress time and space and appearance, make the path shorter, you know, make it shorter. So, for instance, the way I pray is just say, Holy Spirit, I just pray that you ask that you condense my path, make it as short as possible, shrink time as much as possible, make a success come as quickly as possible. You know, just like that. Because escaping this fourth dimensional mindset is quite a challenge. the matrix, the fourth dimensional matrix, is quite a challenge. I'm going to work on that graphic, and I'm going to include the Holy Spirit with that graphic, because that's very important. I left that. I'm gonna adjust the graphic, actually. It was just a step that I was taking. I said, okay, let me see what can be done here. I have an idea. I'm going to do that right now, probably, so. Or later this evening. Whatever, however it works out. Don't rely on your intellect, okay? Do not rely on your intellect. Rely on the Holy Spirit, for sure. Because what is the intellect but the problem solver? So the intellect is simpatico with the fourth dimensional matrix, is the problem. So stay in this mood of repentance, a humble mood, saying, I don't know, I do not know. I don't know anything. I do not know anything. Of course, because all we know is problems, and there are no problems. So just say, I don't know, I do not know anything, is frees you up to hear the truth, to recognize the truth. Because we've been believing there's all these problems are real, and thinking that is knowledge. But it's not knowledge, it's all delusion. So you can say, I don't know anything, like I don't know any mirages, I really don't know. You're stating an openness to see that there are no real mirages. What mirages show us are not really there. It's not really there. It's not really there. It's not real. Not real for us, you see. We're just comparing mirages and thinking there's a relative, comparative reality to different mirages. This mirage has more of this, and this has less of this. And thinking that has sort of meaning. Comparing mirages has some sort of meaning, real meaning. It doesn't have any real meaning. They're all equally still mirages. They're not real. Okay, well, I'm starting to feel this reverberation from doing this video. So, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit is the answer. The Holy Spirit has the answer for us. And we have to use that to escape the fourth dimensional matrix. That's how we escape the fourth dimensional matrix. There is no other way, not the intellect. That won't do it. Those who are using the intellect end up getting sucked into the fourth dimensional matrix and feeling the stress of it, pounding energy drinks, trying to keep up the pace. So, you know, that's a bad situation. I understand that situation. So hopefully I'm being helpful with that here. Because again, the first will be last and the last will be first. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the kingdom. So as you are slowing down, saying, wow, I've got these, you know, I need time to consider this, these breakthroughs and these clarities, I guess it's amazing. And of course you seem to drop off the pace, right? You'll drop off the pace. You'll just be jogging slowly, maybe even walking, and then maybe even sitting. While everybody else is like roaring by in some big train of a marathon, going as fast as they can. So just have the faith that this is true, that more and more you can turn to the Holy Spirit and you get greater and greater and greater clarity, the song of salvation. You can hear it more and more and more and more. And every day for me, it's a great breakthrough, actually. Every day, it's another level of realization, higher realization every day. So, you know, it's just pray to the Holy Spirit and then play it the way that the Holy Spirit has it playing out for you. That's the best advice there is. Okay, very great. I'm getting a major buzz from this video as far as sharing all this, because it's just, it's very heavy material. You know, just very amazing to see this. Okay, very great. That's it.